What would the world look like if people felt like they mattered? Welcome to the Lead with Love podcast, exploring what it means to lead with love in business and life. I'm your host, Jada Selner, and in this show, I'll share meaningful conversations to help you, the creative, the entrepreneur, the world changer, reach more people, go after your dreams, and serve your community with love. I appreciate you joining me. Now let's get cozy and start today's episode. You are going to love this conversation. So my question for you is, are you ready to own your sacred dream that is for the betterment of your community? If you have personal goals, but you know you have a dream that is bigger than yourself, that is full of purpose and service, then this episode is for you. You're listening to episode 140 of the Lead with Love podcast. And in today's conversation, I get cozy with Oprah's favorite guest of all time, Dr. Tererai Trent. We talk about the baton of poverty, rituals, and leading with love. Dr. Trent is one of the world's most acclaimed voices for women's empowerment and quality education. She is the founder of Tererai Trent International, an educator, motivational speaker. If you ever have an opportunity to see her speak live, run to that stage. She has published two highly acclaimed children's books and is the author of the award-winning The Awakened Woman, Remembering and Reigniting Our Sacred Dreams. I am currently listening to this audiobook and it is so, so good. Tererai serves as the president of The Awakened Woman, a company dedicated to empowering women with tools to thrive as they achieve their dreams. As a big dreamer myself, I give a huge amen to this cozy conversation. So let's connect with Dr. Tererai Trent. Hello, Tererai.
Hello, hello. Thank you for having me.
It is an honor to have this conversation with you. You know, I first met you in person in San Francisco, and we were speaking at the Hivery, and I was so inspired by the energy and the storytelling that you brought to the stage. And I just want your story to be shared with as many people as possible. And I'm sipping on some tea right now, and I just had to share the tea inspired message that is in front of me because I feel like it's so relevant to the conversation that we're going to have. And it says, "We are born wise. We are born complete."
Yeah.
And so I know that you say that, you know,
we are the ones we have been waiting for.
Yes. So a question that I always love to start with is, what does leading with love mean to you?
I truly think that leading with love is the key to our leadership, and especially for women's leadership, if we want to be successful, because it is about creating space for others to excel and then to be the source of inspiration by showing what I call our soul wounds, showing our own vulnerability as we lead, and showing our joy and showing our success. I write a lot about leading with love in one of the chapters in my book, The Awakened Woman, where I talk about the expression of our collective and acknowledging one another, giving each other space. It's important for us. For example, in my culture, when we meet, even with people that we know or with strangers, the greeting is always, "Sawubona," which means "I see you," and the other person says, "Ngikhona," "I am here to be seen." This is the kind of leadership that we want, where we see one another. are seen as we are, fully as we are. And in many ways, this greeting is spiritual as we share our humanity. It also says, I value you. I am here to be seen with my joy, to be seen with my vulnerability. See me fully as your sister. And that's what is leading with love. Because when we do that, then we are also willing to engage with integrity. Because we are all equal.
Yes. So powerful. And I talk about the ABCs of love, which is acknowledgement, belonging, and connection. And just to be able to see someone and be fully seen is so powerful. And if people have not gotten their hands on the Awakened Woman book, I highly recommend it. And I highly, highly recommend that you get the Audible, which is what I listen to. And to hear your voice share those stories is so, so powerful.
Thank you. Yeah, you know, when you talk about leading with love, you're also talking about recognizing that you and I, we are a gift to each other. Because when I interact with my team or when I go to my workplace, I am not acting when I meet with my team. They have to know this is me. I am bringing my needs as they are bringing their needs. I am bringing my wounds, my vulnerability as they are also bringing theirs. I'm bringing my dreams. They're also bringing their dreams. So there is this mutual shared love and compassion that we are exemplifying to ourselves and to the world.
I love that. And I know today you take a powerful stand for quality education and women's empowerment. Mm-hmm. But as a child, you were not allowed to go to school because you were a girl. Can you take us back to that little girl and how she felt not being able to have access to education?
As I always say that I come from a long line of generations of women who had been married very young before they could define their dreams. But partly because of poverty and a colonial system that denied many women the right to their education, the right to their dream. So I never had much of education when I was young. And so today, as I work, I also see the little Tererais in my community. And I want every one of them never to be denied that right to education, to be able to gain their education and to be proud of who they are, because education is all about dignity. I was married when I was very young. By the time I was 18, I was already a mother of four without any high school education, without much, and very poor, living in an abusive relationship. But I always think that if women have access to education, if we create platform for women to excel, they will be in a position to be empowered and be able to educate their own children. Because this is about building dignity in our communities. And you know, in my talk, I also talk about how we pass on the baton of illiteracy because we are not educated ourselves. So if my great-grandmother was born holding this baton of illiteracy, the baton of poverty, sure enough, she is going to hand over that baton to the next woman in line, which is my grandmother. And my grandmother also would do the same to my mother. And I would end up with that baton, which is what happened to me. And so I am saying, now I have the platform, the privilege to have other women lean on my shoulders so they can also educate their children and never to pass on that baton, because it silences us. It silences our community. It silences women and the next generation.
Yes. And as a young child, you had a dream, and actually several dreams that you wrote down. And I would love for you to tell us about that dream.
So, you know, what was interesting, I was born in Rhodesia. Today, we are now known as Zimbabwe. So I was born during a colonial system that was so devastating, never respected black people. And so we never had much of education, really. And then when we gained our independence, I met a woman who was visiting. Her name is Jolak. She came to my village and asked me one fundamental question that no one had asked me before. What are your dreams? And I didn't know what to say because no one had asked me that question. And I'm thinking, as a woman, black woman, marginalized, oppressed, am I supposed to dream? And I'm also expecting my number five child. I'm pregnant. And I'm thinking life is already done for me. But she nudged me and said, what are your dreams? That really inspired me to think that here comes a stranger, another woman thinking that I can dream. And I said, I want to go to America, a place that I didn't even know. I want to have an undergraduate, a master's and a PhD. And I was surprised because she looked at me and she said, if you believe in your dreams, they are achievable. And I'm thinking, she must be crazy because I have no high school education. I live in an abusive relationship. How can she even say they are achievable? Me going to America, getting a PhD? Oh my goodness. She saw doubt, I think, and she looked at me and she said, it is achievable. I want you to believe this. If you believe in your dreams and you work hard, you can achieve those dreams. And that was the inspiration that I needed. I ran to my mother, told my mother that I had met a woman who inspired me. My mother said, Tererai, if you believe in what this stranger has said to you, and you truly believe in your dreams, not only are you defining who you are as a woman, but you're also defining every life that comes out of your womb and generations to come. Write down your dreams and bury them the same way we bury the umbilical cord. You know, I come from a culture where when a child is born, the female elders of the village, the grandmothers, they would always snip that umbilical cord.
That is so powerful. And you took that step to bury your dreams.
And bury, they would bury that umbilical cord. So I wrote down my dreams and I had only four and I was ready to bury them when my mother said, read your dreams back. When I did, she said, I see you only have four dreams and they're all your personal dreams. But let me say this, your dreams will have greater meaning when they are tied to the betterment of your community. Your dreams will have greater meaning when they are tied to the greater good. So I would end up writing my fifth dream. When I'm done, I want to come back and improve the lives of women and girls in my community. So the girls, they won't go through what I had gone through. I guess in many ways, my mother wanted me to realize that sometimes it is we find redemption in our own brokenness. I wrote those dreams and buried them, and it would take me 8 years for me to accomplish my high school education. I didn't have enough income to pay for all my classes. I would take two classes at a time, and my mother was a subsistence farmer, and she would help me whenever she manages to sell some of her crops, and she would give me $20 that I needed the subject to write my exams. And after 8 years, I would then find myself at Oklahoma State University. But during those 8 years, my grandmother and my mother, they taught me something that I practice up today. My grandmother would always say, Tererai, you are on a journey to break this vicious cycle of poverty. I want you to go to this place where you have buried your dreams and visualize and make mental images of the life that you want, the life that is breathing deep down under the ground. So I would sit hours and hours in this place and visualize myself getting into an aeroplane that I had never seen, the only plane that I knew were the helicopters, the war helicopters that would come into the communities. And I would visualize myself getting into that helicopter as an aeroplane, taking me to this place called America, and see myself looking at these tall buildings, make mental images of tall buildings, and see myself walking on campus, holding some books and getting into some classes, seeing myself graduating my undergraduate, my master's, and finally my PhD. So when I came to America, in fact, when I got into that aeroplane, there was this deja vu feeling like I've been there, because I had spent my time making those mental images. I was desperate. I wanted to get out of this poverty. I wanted to redefine my life, to have a different life altogether, to make sure that I was not going to pass on that ugly baton to my own girls. I was so determined. I was hungry to change my life. So I was at Oklahoma State University, and I seriously, when I saw those tall buildings, I was tickled. Mm-hmm. And I started taking my classes, and I graduated with my undergraduate. It wasn't easy. It was difficult. But I never gave up. I kept on going. And I always tell women that when a dream is so close to your heart, when a dream is so close to your own brokenness, don't give up. Because these dreams are driven by hunger, great hunger to change our lives. And I talk about two kinds of hungers in our lives. The little hunger, which is all about immediate gratification, and then the great hunger, the hunger that rises within us, the hunger that says, yes, I can change my situation. Sometimes I say, it's not about how, because when you start thinking about how, then you are taking away this energy. Just know that you are here for a purpose. There's greatness within you, and you can do it. And so that really drove me in achieving my dreams.
I love so much the practice in visualization and creating those images in your mind, mm-hmm. and to experience that deja vu, and also eliminating the how, like really that deep, purposeful hunger. That is such a powerful reminder, because I believe that women can get caught in their heads and overthink how they want to pursue their dreams. And I'm curious if there was any challenge or resistance to that fifth dream that your mother called you to tie your personal goals and dreams to the betterment of your community. Did you have any hesitations with that?
No, I never had. At first, I thought I was pleasing my mother. Then when I graduated with my PhD, for some reasons, I couldn't sleep. I couldn't find joy. I would always think about that fifth dream that I'm now calling the sacred dream. It's sacred because it's tied to the betterment of others. And I would think about it and ask myself, how on earth was I going to achieve that fifth dream? Here I am in America. I have my PhD. Why can't I just be happy? How on earth was I going to find money to fulfill that fifth dream? And you know what? As though the universe is always there to connive for our success, I got a phone call from Oprah Winfrey, and she donated $1.5 million towards that fifth dream of improving the lives of women and girls. And today, we are building schools. We have managed to build 11 schools benefiting more than 6,000 boys and girls in some of the remotest rural parts of the country. And I realize all along, my mother knew the universe, the creator, our God, whoever you worship to, whoever you have faith in, will always be there for us. It wasn't about my personal goals in this life. It wasn't about my degrees, but it was about how these personal goals in our lives are connected to the greater good. And now I find so much joy when I see these little girls and boys excelling in their classes. It brings me healing and redemption.
So powerful. I'm so inspired by that. The gift of giving back. You received the education and you have exponentially poured it back into your community. Mm-hmm. And I know that Oprah said in the 25 years of interviewing thousands and thousands of people, and she said 4,651 to be exact, that the story of Tererai Trent was the most remarkable. And at the end of 25 seasons, I listed it as my all-time favorite of all time. And when you received that phone call from Oprah, I'm just so curious how that relationship unfolded to really fuel that dream of creating more education for more young girls and boys.
You know, when Oprah said that I am her all-time favorite guest, she gave platform to the empowerment of women and girls, to the empowerment of humanity. It's not about me being the all-time favorite, but more about how we carry this vessel of our beliefs and our dreams. So Oprah had read a book, Half the Sky, by Nicholas Kristof, and loved the stories because there was my story. And she wanted to see me. So in 2009, I appeared on her show. And then in 2011, she called me back. And that's when she surprised me with the $1.5 million for my sacred dream. And when she announced that I was her all-time favorite guest, I, even up to now, I can't wrap my head over it. Mm. I am humbled by that. She's quite a remarkable woman. Ever since we have been friends, we talk, and to be in the presence of such a giant, she reminds me of what my mother always said, that women here on earth, we are climbing an invisible ladder. The invisible ladder has its own laws that we need to abide to. As we climb, there are other women who are at the top of the rung of that invisible ladder, and there are others who are at the bottom. And those who are at the top, sometimes they have a moral obligation, a spiritual obligation, to pull those who are at the bottom so that we can all achieve our dreams. And there was Oprah. At the top of that ladder on her rung, she looked below and realized that, hey, there are other women below the rung with children, with girls and boys who are suffering. And she pulled me and all those in my communities and the work that I now am now doing in the world. She pulled me up and created this platform to excel.
Yes. And your book, The Awakened Woman, Remembering and Reigniting Our Sacred Dreams, you talk about rituals. And I'm curious what your favorite tradition or ritual that helps you stay connected to your dreams.
I think this morning I did a post on rituals on Facebook. I breathe rituals. I am rituals. Every morning before dawn, I have 3 or 4 rituals that I can pick from. I can do visualization because I'm a dreamer. I'm always dreaming. And I can also do a visualization on the peace that I want to see in the world, the women that are suffering, and what I can do to reach out to those women. I also do what I call fierce writing. When I want to purge the pain or any negative thoughts in myself, I find myself taking that pen and paper and write furiously and letting everything out. Sometimes I write 10 pages. I don't even look at what I have written. I write as I am guided and I put it out there. And after I'm done, I find this feeling of being washed clean. And sometimes I do what I call wailing prayer, where I raise my voice in prayer. Digging deep within the chambers of who I am, knowing there's greatness within me, knowing I am part of the solution, and I am praying and giving my gratitude to everything that has happened to me and to what is going to happen.
I can feel the energy pulsating of how powerful those rituals are.
Yeah. Because rituals, they give us meaning. They give us direction to a journey that is difficult. They hold that space for our faith and our spiritual growth and help us to reinforce in our belief system. I can't do without rituals. My grandmother would always say that while rituals guide us in our everyday life, we should not forget that rituals are the highest platform for which to show our gratitude, for which to be thankful.
Yes, and with writing this book, I feel that it is a piece of your heart, your soul journey. And I'm curious what has been exciting and also challenging about getting this body of work that lives within you out into paper and to the world.
Writing a book can be challenging, but it can also be part of our healing. For me, I wanted to own my voice, own my story. Because when we don't own our voices and tell our stories and define who we are, we then let the world define us. And I never wanted others to define me. So when I was writing, it was difficult because I had to confront my past. We can only find redemption and find ourselves and come home to ourselves if we are able to confront our past and its ugliness. We have to. So for me, I had to sit down and really look at that past and look at the soul wounds that I was carrying and ask myself, am I what happened to me? Am I the soul wounds that I carry? Is this what I am settling for? So in my book, I said, no, I am not settling for that. My story, my past is just a springboard for me to see a better future for myself. So as I was writing, I was finding healing in that because I didn't only include my story. I also include stories of other women who have also achieved their own dreams. Stories of suffering, stories of pain, but stories of never giving up, stories of digging deep within us and seeing the greatness that we all have. and share some of the tools and exercises so other women can also find their own redemption.
So inspiring. I'm getting chills. And there's a question that you ask. I recently enrolled in your course called the Awakened Women Lessons, which is really expanding and deepening into what you share inside your book. And the first lesson is titled Unlocking What Breaks Your Heart. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious for you, what breaks your heart today?
So what breaks my heart, and it still does today, is to see the disempowerment and the silencing of women in the world. Because when women are silenced, they shelve their dreams. And what it means is their own daughters and sons will also shelve their dreams as well. And I truly believe that the awakening of women is really the healing of the world. When we create platforms for women to empower and lead with love, women can change this world for the better. And no wonder why I am working in this field. Because sometimes what breaks our heart is the very thing that brings redemption and healing in our life. Because in our brokenness, we begin to hear the voice of reasoning, the stirring in our belly, the stirring in our heart, to right the wrongs that have been done to others, to right the wrongs that have been done to us. So the work that I am doing is part of my healing. It's not like I'm a champion. It's not like I am doing something extraordinary. I'm just an ordinary woman trying to find her own healing. And this work of creating platforms for women to empower, of creating platforms for children to have better education, is part of my journey. It's my healing. It's part of healing my soul wounds. It's part of finding myself. It's part of me coming home to myself. And I want other women as well to recognize that sometimes adversity is a gift in our life, because through that adversity, we begin to find our calling and we find healing as well.
Wow. One thing I see you speaking all over the world, and I know you're getting ready to fly back to Africa shortly, and I'm so curious how you balance these big sacred dreams and ambitions with creating space for downtime, for reflection, for connection.
Mm-hmm. You know, I always say that downtime is needed. And for me, it's not about finding balance, but it's about finding the self-care we need. And I call that spiritual self-care, which is vital for our healing because it helps create a space for us to be in tune with ourselves. It also helps us to connect with our inner power, so that we can build more confidence and be able to be ready to go and face the world, so we can build authentic relationships, quality relationships with ourselves and with others that we interact with. We cannot change, or we cannot expect to change what's in the world unless we first take care of what lies deeply within us. We need healing. Otherwise, if we don't give ourselves that time to come home to ourselves, we'll go out in the world with our wounds, our pain, and our hurt. No matter what we share, the world will see that we are not coming from a place of empowerment. We are not coming from a place of healing. We are still carrying our burdens and our wounds, and we won't feel genuine about it. So I have taken about 2 weeks. I just came back from Australia and New Zealand where I spoke, and then I went to, my last speaking was in Seattle, and I took 2 weeks, full 2 weeks, just to wail, to self-care, where I didn't do much. Sitting in this corner in my house, the spiritual corner, and really finding peace within myself, rejuvenate my soul and my spirit. As I prepare myself to go home to Africa, where there might be challenges along the way. So every now and again on my calendar, I say, there are no speaking engagements. There are no serious projects. I have to have my 2-3 weeks of just being me, me in my world, me coming home to myself. And when I am done, I am so fired up. And when I go for my next speaking, even myself, I can tell I was a woman on fire.
I love that. I love the space and the energy of rejuvenating yourself and refueling and serving from that overflow. I know you mentioned that your sacred dream was a part of pleasing your mother. And I am just so curious, after you accomplished dream one, dream two, dream three, dream four, and then your sacred dream five, was there anything that your mother shared with you or said with you?
So, you know, my mother died in 2013, but she had seen most of the progress, and she had seen the achievement of all my dreams, and including the fifth dream. And I remember having a discussion with my mother, and I said, "Mother, I am now tired of digging the ground and bury my dreams. I'm tired of writing my dreams. I want to bury my dreams in the hearts of women. I want to inspire 1 million women so they can each get my book. They can buy 10 books and share 9 copies of the books with other women who are facing some silencing in their life. They can leave the books on the train or find individuals who are homeless and just give the book. That way, we then create enough funding and a movement with women who would help to create that funding so we can educate more children in the world. Because my fear has always been, we have had so much success with our education. Most of the kids are now going to universities and colleges, but they still come from a very poor place. I want to create an employment platform for the mothers and grandmothers of these children so they can be employed and be the ones sending their children to universities. Right now, I do send some of these children to universities. But if anything happens to me, it means those children will come back home. So what a way of galvanizing and rallying my sisters in the world and create this movement that can create this platform for an endowment fee or endowment revenue so we can sustain the education system in the rural areas. That's my dream right now.
Oh, so powerful. And I love the simple call to action to buy 10 and give 9 away and leaving them in random places for those who are experiencing adversity and carrying those soul wounds right now, to just open the pages and be sparked to truly step in and be called forward to their dreams that feel unattainable right now. You are proof of possibility.
We are all, I think, within us, all of us, yeah. But I think it's a question of asking ourselves, what drives my hunger in this life? How do I use my resources for the betterment of myself, but also for the betterment of others?
This is so powerful. And I'd love to know, before we wrap up, if there's anything that you'd like to share before we say goodbye.
I think we have covered pretty much everything, except to rally my women friends, my sisters, to join my online classes that I am offering. We have What Breaks Your Heart, and another one is coming very soon, Healing from Our Soul Wounds. I have 7 classes altogether. So it would be humbling if my sisters can join me, because part of the proceeds are also going towards the mission of educating our children. And we have to realize that we have more than 100 million girls that are being denied the right to education. And so this would be an opportunity for my sisters to join me, and we can make a difference. Yeah.
And where can they go? I'll definitely link to the show notes as well. And I've already ordered and pre-ordered these lessons, because it is activating a huge ripple effect of impact and change in the world. Where can they go to get access?
They can go to Tererai online classes, or they can just type tereraitrent.org and they would find the classes on my website.
Yes, and that's tererai.org.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Dr. Tererai Trent, for your wisdom, for being a wisdom keeper and calling us forward to step into our sacred dreams. It's an honor and a privilege.
Oh, the honor is mine. Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your heart and attention in listening to Lead with Love. If this message, leading with love in life and business, and remembering the humans and beating hearts behind the numbers and all of that good stuff, I would love for you to take the time to leave an honest review. It would mean the world to me, and it also helps more people find out about the goodness and helping spreading more love in the world, which we really, really need. So I would really appreciate that, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye.